Charles Dwayne Burley, known to the world as Charley Burley, born September 6, 1917, in Bessemer, Pennsylvania. Burley is the most recognizable member of what is today called the Black Murderers Row. He was known for his unorthodox angles, consistent jab, elusive defense, and quick counterpunching. Archie Moore called him as slick as lard and twice as greasy. From 1938 to 1947, Burley fought the Black Murderers Row 18 times, traveling from Baltimore to San Francisco. What each man shared is their exceptional ability in the boxing ring and the fact that none of them ever got an opportunity to fight for a world title in boxing. Listen, this is the story of Charles Dwayne Burley. His father was a black coal miner, and his mother was a white Irish immigrant. In 1925, Charlie's father was killed in an industrial accident, and his family would move to Pittsburgh. At just 12 years old, Burley entered the local boys' club boxing ring as a lightweight, winning city, state, and national junior boxing titles, along with the Golden Gloves title. Charley had not just passion in the squared circle for boxing, but on the diamond playing baseball, where he excelled. The Homestead Grays, a great and highly respected team in the Negro Leagues, offered Burley a contract. Shortly after, another offer was on the table for Charley to fight in the 1936 Summer Olympics, held in Berlin, Germany. But he declined the invitation in protest of Nazi Germany and their regime. This was the same Olympic Games that African-American track star Jesse Owens dominated with 4 gold medals, as Adolf Hitler watched in disbelief. Instead, Burley opted to fight in the Worker Games in Republican Spain, ahead of World War II. The games were canceled due to the Spanish Civil War. Charley Burley would go on to make his professional debut on September 29, 1936, against George Liggins at the Moose Temple in Pittsburgh, winning by knockout. On August 22, 1938, Burley defeated Black Murderers Row Herbert Lewis Hardwick, aka Coco Kid, for the World Colored Welterweight Championship by unanimous decision. Burley floored Coco Kid 3 times and defeated him decisively. Charley was now ranked number 1 from August to November of 1939, and word around the East Coast boxing gyms was Burley was a major threat for the welterweight king, Henry Armstrong. Armstrong ignored him. Burley wasn't connected or protected. Armstrong was close to Joe Louis, and Black Murderers Row Holman Williams was a mentor to Joe Louis. And in October 1940, Burley was ranked number 1, and Coco Kid was ranked number 2. Armstrong ignored them both and fought number 3, Fritzy Zivic, instead. Burley had already beaten him twice. Charley said, "I used to get down on my knees and pray that I'd get a title shot." Writers speculated if Holman Williams was put in front of Charley to protect Armstrong, the term they called a policeman, when someone would be sent in front of a threat. On December 1, 1939, he battled Holman Williams in the first of a 7-fight rivalry. The fight took place in New Orleans at the Coliseum Arena. Burley dropped Williams 3 times in the 4th round, but Williams took control and won a decision. To begin his impressive 1942, Charley defeated both Shorty Hogue and Big Boy Hogue, the notable boxing brothers. he stopped Shorty and retired Big Boy. On March 13, 1942, at the Armory in Minnesota, Burley, having issues securing an opponent, fought a heavyweight, J.D. Turner, who outweighed him by 70 pounds. Turner said after the fight, quote, "That little son of a gun hit me with a left hook and I woke up in the dressing room." Burley turned his face to raw beefsteak. J.D. couldn't answer the bell, and Burley won by TKO in round 7. The following month, Charley Burley ran into Sugar Ray Robinson in the lobby of a hotel in New York. Charley was fighting Phil McQuillan on April 20th, 1942. When Burley and Robinson wound up on the same card April 30th, 1942, a week later at the Minneapolis Armory, Charley KO'd Sammy Wilson in 2 rounds. As did Ray KO Dick Banner in 2 rounds. When Sugar Ray watched Charley Burley's performance from ringside, he told his manager, quote, "I'm too pretty to fight Charley Burley." Burley would go on to win the rematch against Holman Williams in February of 1942 at the Armory in Minneapolis by unanimous decision. The third fight took place on June 23, 1942, at Crosley Field in Cincinnati. Burley would also win again by decision. During his series with Holman Williams, Burley also fought in May and June of 1942 against Ezzard Charles, 35 days apart. Burley lost both fights by decision. On August 14, 1942, at the Victory Arena in New Orleans, Charley defeated Holman Williams for the World Colored Middleweight title, winning by TKO in 9 rounds. A couple months later, on October 16, 1942, Holman returned the favor, winning a decision at Municipal Auditorium in New Orleans and capturing the World Colored Middleweight title. On December 11, 1942, he lost the split decision to Black Murderers Row Lloyd Marshall at Legion Stadium in Hollywood. He would later say that Marshall was one of his toughest fights. On February 19, 1943, he defeated Black Murderers Row Jack Chase by decision at Legion Stadium in Hollywood. On March 3, 1943, he defeated Black Murderers Row Aaron Wade by decision at the Auditorium in Oakland, fighting with a damaged right hand. A rematch with Coco Kid at Pelican Stadium in New Orleans on April 19, 1943, ended in a draw. And when Burley rematched Aaron Wade March 24, 1944, he won a decision at the Coliseum in San Diego. On April 6, 1944, Burley defeated Black Murderers Row Jack Chase again in a rematch, winning the California State Middleweight Championship by KO in round 9. A few weeks later, Burley was working at an aircraft factory in his then hometown of San Diego. He got a call to be a late replacement to fight Archie Moore. On April 21, 1944, with a busted eardrum, he finished his shift, got on a bus, and headed to Legion Stadium in Hollywood. Burley outclassed and defeated Archie Moore by decision, dropping him in the first, third, and fourth rounds. Moore, who reflected years later, said, "Charley Burley, pound for pound, the greatest fighter I ever faced. Charley gave me a licking and sent me back to school. I learned more in our fight than any other. That man was fantastic. He could lean away from a punch, be clear off balance, and knock your brains out with a counter." On September 11, 1944, Burley fought Jack Chase for a third time, winning by TKO and capturing the California State Middleweight Championship again. On July 11, 1945, he fought his final fight against Holman Williams, ending their rivalry. Williams would win a decision at the Civic Stadium in Buffalo. The Burley-Williams rivalry had ended in an even split between 1939 and 1945. Burley won 3, Williams won 3, and one was ruled a no contest in 1943 due to inactivity in the ring from both fighters. On August 20th, 1945, he defeated Aaron Wade for a third time at Forbes Field in Pittsburgh, winning a decision. The Pittsburgh Press wrote about Burley's hard time securing the world champions of his era, quote, "Every good middleweight around has been offered a fat purse to step in the ring with Burley, and each one in turn has nixed the proposition." This included the King, Sugar Ray Robinson. Burley was willing to fight him for nothing. Quote, "They can give him my purse too," he said. Robinson, said the Pittsburgh Press, quote, "prefers to keep his reputation and let Burley and the local promoters keep the $20,000 they offered for the night's work." Late in 1946, he defeated black murderers Robert Littell in Pennsylvania by decision. And when they rematched February 17, 1947 in Baltimore, Littell returned the favor and won a decision over Burley. He found himself broke in 1947 as he couldn't get a fight. But he was respected in cities like Los Angeles, where they treated him, quote, like Jesus Christ. Burley was forced to return home and work as a part-time garbage man in Pittsburgh. He only fought once in 1948. Boxing legends and world champions Billy Kahn, Marcel Cerdan, and Sugar Ray Robinson sidestepped the slick Pittsburgh warrior, leaving his ultimate glory out of reach. Sugar Ray Robinson had even signed for a May 1946 fight with Charley Burley, but raised the price to close to $25,000 when he wanted an out. When Sports Illustrator asked if he would have beaten Sugar Ray Robinson, Charley Burley said, quote, "I wish I had my chance. I was offered but wouldn't take no dives. I was told I could fight Sugar Ray Robinson 3 times, but I had to lose the first. I wouldn't do it. I never took no money, and that's the guy's truth. It wasn't my style." Sugar Ray once said, "Anyone who would pursue a fight with Burley would have to be crazy. He was a tremendously dangerous fighter. I have to admit, I have my doubts that I could have licked him in my prime years." Eddie Futch, who trained Joe Frazier, Ken Norton, Larry Holmes, and Trevor Burbick, 4 of the 5 men who defeated Muhammad Ali, stated that Burley, quote, was the finest all-around fighter he ever saw. Burley's final fight was July 22, 1950 against Pilar Bastidas in Peru. He won by decision. Burley was never KO'd in 98 fights. He had 50 knockouts and fought fighters from welterweight to heavyweight. In 1976, he was still working as a garbage man at the age of 59. And by 1981, he was retired and remarked, "Nobody cares about me anymore." Soon after, the Charley Burley Award was created by a local organization for the outstanding boxer of the district Silver Mittens final. Burley would present the trophy. Magazines recognized him as one of the greatest punchers of all time. He was inducted into the Boxing Hall of Fame in 1983 and World Boxing Hall of Fame in 1987. He was posthumously enshrined in the International Boxing Hall of Fame in 1992. In 2008, the Burley family received the key to the city of Pittsburgh, and August 5th was proclaimed Charley Burley Day. Playwright August Wilson, who grew up idolizing Charley in Pittsburgh, who went on to win the Pulitzer Prize, described Burley as the first image he had of a man. Wilson said he used to live across the street, and I'd go over there and watch TV. Charlie would take his knuckles, rub them on your head and say, "Hey, champ," and it hurt like hell, but you couldn't let him know it hurt. When August Wilson wrote the popular stage play turned movie Fences, the main character Troy was based on Charley Burley. The setting was the backyard of a house in Pittsburgh, and the plot follows a former Negro League baseball player who is now a bitter garbage man. The parallels with Burley are clear. The main character, Troy, was played by two icons, James Earl Jones in 1987 and Denzel Washington in 2016. The play and film won the Pulitzer Prize in 1987 and Tony Award for Best Play. Burley finished his career with 83 wins, 12 losses, 2 draws, and 1 no contest. On October 16, 1992, at the age of 75, Charles Duane Burley passed away, fading into the history books as one of the kings of Black Murderers Row. Until now.